Thank you. So good morning, everyone. This is the last lecture. I'll be here for through the coffee break, but at the end of the coffee break, unfortunately, I have to leave. So make sure that, you know, if you have questions at the end, you come up to me, because that's the last opportunity. But of course, you do have my email address, and feel free to contact me, to send me mail if you have questions. So let me start today's lecture from we've been discussing a bit the you know, to which extent QCD calculations can be accurate, what are the tools that we've developed to better understand the structure of the final states. I gave some examples of processes for which we have next to leading order results. Precision is in the range of 10%. Say for jets, we discussed yesterday the top cross-section a bit, and I told you that we're down at the level of 5%. Nowadays, there is the next to leading order calculation available. The question is, how far can one really go? And of course, one can ideally, arbitrarily improve on the theory side by just doing more and more and more advanced calculations, two loops, three loops, etc. It's a very complicated program, because it's not enough to have a calculation, say, at three loops of a matrix element. That's something that everybody can do, in the sense it's you sitting down and doing a calculation, if you can. But at that level of precision, you also need parton distribute the PDFs, of course. And the PDFs is not something that you can settle yourself. You need very accurate data to be used. And you need very accurate predictions for those specific observables that have to be compared against the data. So it's not obvious. It's very hard to extrapolate what the ultimate precision will be in the future. Certainly, things will continue improving. So one thing which is interesting is to try to see if there are other ways in which we can achieve precision by playing with what we have. And one possibility, which I would like to introduce you to, is this idea of looking at cross-section ratios at different energies. Namely, we look at a process at, say, 7 TeV collision, and we look at exactly the same process at 14 TeV. Now, this is something that 5 years ago, we would have never considered, simply because VLHC was supposed to start at 14 TeV and to run all of its life at 14 TeV. For whatever reason, it had to start at lower energy because the dipoles could not cope as they were with a higher energy. So we do have a large data sample at 7 and 8 TeV, and now we're moving to 13. And this provides opportunities that then people started thinking about how to exploit. So what is suggested here is to look at the ratio. We take a process, X. E1 and E2 are two different beam energies. And we look at the ratio of the cross-section for the process X at one energy over the other one. So what happens when we take this ratio is that typically several origins or theoretical systematic uncertainties cancel. For example, the mass of the top is the mass of the top. It doesn't matter what's the energy. So even though we don't know the mass of the top very precisely, and therefore the top cross-section has some residual 3% uncertainty coming from not knowing the mass of the top, but what we know is that the mass of the top will be the same at 13 TeV and at 8 TeV. So when we look at the systematics of the mass of the top on the cross-section ratio, which means that we take the ratio and we calculate the ratio for different values of the top mass, we have to take exactly the same top mass in the numerator, in the denominator, okay? And this ratio will not be exactly one, because of course, if the top is heavier, the cross-section will be, the ratio will be slightly larger, just because at higher energy, the cross-section for a heavier top is bigger, but certainly will be much, much more stable. Likewise, alpha S, if we have an uncertainty on the value of alpha S, again, yes, we have it, but it's fully correlated. So there are correlations, there are PDF correlations, and the expectation is that they will cancel. Also, scale uncertainties, namely the uncertainties due to the intrinsic lack of higher order corrections, should be correlated. Because if we're looking at exactly the same process, then at the partonic level, we're dealing with exactly the same object, and say scale variations, which arise from the presence of logs coming out of the normalization process, they will be fully correlated. It's legitimate to take the same scale at one energy as we are taking at the different energy, because again, you know, to the extent that we are dealing with exactly the same process with exactly the same kinematics, because it has to be at the same, say, the same PT if we're looking at jets, the loop corrections will give rise to renormalization will be the same. And likewise, experimentally, of course, taking ratios, several of the experimental systematics will cancel. So there is the expectation that these ratios are something that could be predicted theoretically with precisions well beyond, well below 1%, and likewise, hopefully, experimentally, can achieve similar precisions. In addition to that, one can look at double ratios. Namely, we take two processes and we look at the cross-section ratio of a process relative to another one at a given energy, and then we take the ratio of this ratio at a different energy. The reason to do that is that, for example, in this way there is absolutely no luminosity uncertainty. What's the luminosity uncertainty? Luminosity is pretty much the measure of the number of collisions that have taken place. If I want to know a cross-section, I count the number of events out of the number of collisions, and that tells me what's the probability for that process. But that requires that I know exactly how many collisions have taken place. And it's very hard experimentally and from the point of view of the accelerator to determine very precisely the number of collisions, the intensity of the bunches, right? Because we want to know it to 1%. That's very hard to do. Of course, the luminosity is exactly the same independently of what is the process that I'm looking at. So if I measure the Z cross-section and the W cross-section, I'm counting events of Z boson decay, W boson decay. If I take the ratio of this number of events, of course, the absolute luminosity will drop out. Okay, so that is independent of that, and that's one reason why we do this. The reason is that the luminosities are not correlated at different energies because it's independent runs, and therefore they have independent systematic uncertainties. The typical uncertainty at the LHC on the determination of the luminosity, so the absolute event rate, is of the order of 2.5%. Okay, so that by itself sets the optimal limit, the asymptotic limit to the precision of any experimental measurement. So let us see in practice what that means. In this table, which contains, of course, many numbers, as you see, there are several processes, and this table represents the ratios of given cross-sections or ratios of cross-sections at 14 normalized to 8 TeV. So this is, for instance, the double ratio. We take the TT bar cross-section normalized by the Z cross-section at a given energy divided by that ratio at a different energy. This is the value of this specific double ratio, so it's a number. And these are the uncertainties in relative percent coming from the PDFs, coming from the uncertainty on alpha S, and coming from the scales, so the perturbative uncertainty coming from the fact that we don't know the process with up to beyond the given order in perturbation theory. And as you see, all of these numbers are in the range or below 1%. The TT bar cross-section itself, so the absolute TT bar cross-section at 14 TV divided by the TT bar cross-section at 8 TV is known with you see, it's a fraction of a percent. This is from minus 0.38% plus 1.07%. So it's a plus or minus 0.7%. So it's better than 1%. I remind you, the absolute cross-section itself at a fixed energy due to the scale is more like 3%. So we improve by a factor of 4 that systematics. The PDF uncertainty, which was about another 3-4%, is down to 0.8%, etc. There are processes like, for example, the Z and W production, where things are even more remarkable. We're talking about, 0.1. This is really per mil accuracy, 3 per mil, 1 per mil, 4 per mil, 3 per mil in the PDF uncertainties. Now, when we have a prediction which is so precise, of course, we become, the prediction is very precise also because indeed this ratio is very constrained. So we cannot expect that we do a measurement and this ratio will be, 20-30% away from our prediction. Nevertheless, with this level of accuracy, by canceling many systematical uncertainties, we are sensitive to possible slight deviations from what we expect. For example, the PDFs indeed could make extrapolations that are not very well controlled, because by going to higher energy we change the range in X, and therefore this is a very important independent test of the PDFs. And this is shown in the table below. These PDF uncertainties were coming from a given set of PDFs. Down here we're comparing the results and the uncertainties of different sets. So these labels correspond to, you remember what we saw in the first day, different groups doing PDF fits. And if you go through this table, you see that there are several examples in which predictions from different PDF sets differ at the level of 3 or 4 sigma, even in the case of the W and the Z rates. So that means that once we will have precise measurements at 13 TV, we look at the ratio W cross-section from 13 or 14 TV to 7, 8 TV, and we have a probe, and we can tell, whether a set of PDFs is right or wrong at the level of 3 sigma. So it's an additional useful independent tool to improve our knowledge about the proton. In addition to that, it could be also of interest to probe possible new physics. So let's look at these considerations. Let us assume that we're looking at a final state which receives both standard model and beyond the standard model contributions. This could be, for example, top production. I mentioned yesterday at some point, we produce TT bar, but we could be producing stop anti-stop, the supersymmetric pattern of the top, and the stop decays to the top. So the final state of a stop anti-stop will contain a TT bar. So when we go and we measure the TT bar cross-section, we might be including a contamination from other new physics. So we are adding then, what the experiments will see is the sum of a standard model contribution plus the BSM contribution. Now let us look at the ratio, therefore, of what the experiments see at two different energies. Well, here I put in 7 and 8, but you can just put E1 and E2. So this is our ratio, R7-8. And we can plug in this expression. So take into account that both numerator and denominator contain a standard model and a BSM contribution. And we can expand this contribution by assuming that the BSM is actually small. Okay, if it's big, then presumably things will be seen right away. We are working under the assumption that the BSM contribution is so small that one really needs a very sophisticated, a very precise probe to be able to see it. So that justifies, in this ratio, expanding in powers of BSM contribution. And what you can easily find is that, therefore, this ratio is equal to the standard model ratio times 1 plus something which is proportional, of course, to the ratio between the BSM and the standard model. That's obvious. The larger is the BSM, the larger is the correction. But then there is a term, this delta 7-8, which is expanded here, but in words, it represents how much the ratio of BSM to standard model varies as a function of energy, because obviously we're sensitive to that. If the BSM contribution at 70 eV were 10%, and the BSM contribution at 14 eV were also 10%, when we take the ratio, we don't see a difference, right? BSM is equal, for example, to 0.1 times standard model at both energies, then standard model plus BSM will be equal to 1.1 times standard model at a given energy. And if we do it at the other energy, this is E1, and if we do it at E2, and the ratio remains the same, we also have 1.1 standard model. So this ratio is exactly 1. We don't see any deviation. So in order for us to see something, we need the BSM contribution to vary as a function of energy in a different way than the standard model contribution. And that's why there is this additional term. So the BSM contribution has to be visible, there has to be some, and then it has to evolve in a different way. Okay? So this is the bottom line. And why should it evolve differently? Well, there are many reasons why it should evolve differently. For example, the origin of this BSM contribution could be different. If we are looking at, the TT bar cross-section, let's say we have a contribution that comes from a resonance, a Z prime, that decays to TT bar. And let's say that this Z prime has a mass which is, 500 GeV. So 500 GeV is larger than the minimum, than the threshold for the production of TT bar. In order to produce this resonance, we need to put in at least 500 GeV. So it's obvious, and number one. Number two, the Z prime will come from a QQ bar annihilation, while TT bar comes from a glu glu annihilation. So as we go to higher energy, of course, it becomes much easier to produce a very heavy object if we have more energy available. So the contribution, the relative fraction of TT bar events that come from Z prime will be significantly larger and higher energy than it is at lower energy, because going to higher energy, it's easier to produce these Z primes. And this is what will give rise to this dependence. So here are some examples of how these luminosities of different initial states evolve, ratio of luminosities at different energies evolve. And the bottom line is the following. The bottom line is that since these energy ratio, cross-section ratios predictions have a precision at the level of a fraction of a percent, there is sensitivity to contributions coming from BSM processes at the level of a few percent. Okay? Typically, if we have a 3% contamination to the top cross-section, we wouldn't see it from the measurement of a top cross-section, because we know that there is a 3-4% uncertainty, so it will be hidden within this uncertainty. But that 3% contamination could be visible if we look at the ratios between 14 TV and 7 TV, just because the ratio is much, much more robust, is much more precisely determined. So one example of a possible application of these ideas came up during run one. At some point during run one, there were measurements of a WW cross-section at 7 TV and the WW cross-sections at 8 TV. This is the theoretical prediction, this red point with the uncertainty. These were the measurements from 7 TV from the experiments. You see slightly high, only one sigma, but certainly high, all of them. And this was the first measurement that was reported by CMS at 8 TV, and it starts being again high. So by looking at the relation between the theory and the data here and here, you wouldn't conclude much, because as we said, it's one sigma, right? On the other hand, and that's because this uncertainty, these error bars are quite large. On the other hand, if we take the ratio between these two measurements, a lot of the systematics go away in principle, and therefore the discrepancy between the ratio of the data and the ratio of the theory could be enhanced and become maybe 3 or 4 sigma. Now, in this case, unfortunately, the experimental uncertainty is not coming from systematics. It's really coming from statistics, because at 70 eV, especially, the luminosity was relatively low. So most of these uncertainty band is actually statistics. And statistics, there is nothing you can do about, right? Because that is fully uncorrelated. On the other hand, asymptotically, when the statistics will be very, very good and we are just down to fighting against the systematics, this is a powerful technique. Incidentally, the ratio of cross sections, 8 over 7 for the WW final state, has an uncertainty that, as you see, is at the level of 3 per mil. Okay? So, in principle, it is really a very solid prediction. Now, just to make sure that you don't walk out of this room assuming that there is no physics there, this is the current situation with the WW cross section. On one side, there are now more precise experimental measurements coming from 8 TV, both ATLAS and CMS completed the measurements. On the other, the major new ingredient was the completion of the next to leading order calculation for the WW cross section. And this is, for example, for 7 TV, you see it adds a bit, a 10% effect. There is another 10% effect coming at 8 TV. This is the contribution to the WW final state, to the cross section coming from the Higgs channel. It's not immense, it's like 6 or 7%, but it's important. And this is the comparison with the data. So these are the data, 54.4, 52.4, plus or minus 5 and 6 from ATLAS and CMS. This was the original calculation next to leading order, and you see indeed it's almost 2 sigma, right, the discrepancy. But if we go to next to leading order, it's 50 against 55, 53, plus or minus 5, so it's down to being 1 sigma. And if we look at the 8 TV data, here there is a bit of an internal inconsistency in the data themselves. ATLAS reports 70, which certainly is high, because even at next to leading order, we have 60. So this is 70 plus or minus 6 against 60. So it's 1.5 to 2 sigma. CMS reports 60. One has to add the glue-glue contribution, which is not... I apologize. This measurement here by ATLAS includes the Higgs. So we have to add this number, the Higgs contribution, to the pure next to leading order WW cross section. So the theoretical prediction is 60 plus 4. It's 64, which within 1 sigma is compatible with these 72. Okay? Sigma and a half, perhaps. And here CMS does not have the Higgs. There is the Higgs subtracted. The measurement is 60, and the theory 60, so this is perfectly compatible. So there is a slight discrepancy at the level of a couple of sigma between ATLAS and CMS, and that, so we have to wait. We will wait for these measurements at 14 TV, and in particular, if there is something weird, we will look at the ratios. Question? So the question is, why ATLAS and CMS at 8 TV, one decided to maintain the Higgs and the other decided to leave it out? It's just a choice. I mean, the measurements at 7 TV, they preceded the established confirmation of the existence of the Higgs, so they were just looking at WW pairs, and they could not do the subtraction, but they didn't know that the Higgs was there. Okay? And that's why. And then, of course, these analyses, because of historical heritage somehow, got done in the same way at 8 TV by ATLAS. CMS, this measurement came out a few months ago, so at that point they had the time to refine the tools to do the subtraction of the Higgs. So there is no specific reason.
In general, what you're saying is that
Well, you know, this is the Higgs going to WW, right, and going to leptons. So it's a contribution that it's there, and in principle, on an event-by-event basis, you don't know whether it's a Higgs or whether it's a W pair. So you have to subtract it by running the Monte Carlo. So if you wish, the key difference between including it and removing it is that including it means not doing anything. So including typically means that you do something. No, here including means you are not doing anything because you just look at the data and you count the events and that's the cross-section, right? No Higgs means doing work because you have to run the Monte Carlo through your experiment and seeing what is the acceptance and then decide to take away those events. So it's a less clean. It's a measurement which is not just an experimental measurement. It also includes a theoretical bias. And there, you know, it's a matter of philosophy, what you prefer. To the extent that, you know, the modeling of Higgs production and decay is reliable, the theoretical modeling, this is a safe thing. One has to also take into account that the contribution is not immense. And you see, it's quoted as being, sorry, this is the theoretical cross-section. I cannot remember what is the experimental systematics coming from the removal of the Higgs. I don't know how large that is, but anyway.
What benefit do you actually derive from removing the Higgs?
What's the benefit that one derives from removing the Higgs? The benefit is that, you know, theoretically, the calculation of a Higgs contribution and the calculation of the pure WW are two different calculations, right? And up to a point, because here there start being interferences. So if you just try to remove every contamination, it just boils down to being 100% WW. In theory, it's a more straightforward theoretical calculation, right? But it's a matter of philosophy, and as always, the only thing that's really important is that it be explained exactly what was done. It doesn't, you know, they could quote the cross-section divided by two, and we can argue whether, you know, you want the cross-section or the cross-section divided by two. You know, if you tell me that you divide it by two, fine, I will divide by two my calculation, and I can still live with that, okay? What's important is that things get documented very precisely so that everybody can reproduce them. And incidentally, this plot here is just as a function of energy, the theoretical cross-sections at leading order, next to leading order, which as you see is a large contribution, and finally next to leading order, which is a relatively small addition, and which therefore suggests that the next to next to next will probably not be immense. All right, this is another way of looking at, you know, trying to generate some precise measurements and precise theoretical predictions. This is the ratio. Now we're at a fixed energy. These are data from, I believe, it's written here, 87 TeV. Yeah. This is a ratio of the W plus jets and the Z plus jet cross-section as a function of multiplicity, as a function of a PT, for example, of a second leading jet. And you see the scale here, for example, the absolute rate, how many events there are, W plus jets divided by Z plus jets. Experimentally, the measurement is very precise as long as there is statistics. And you see it agrees with theory, at least with this theory, at the level of, you know, literally 3-4%, which is... And here, too, we see it's an excellent agreement. Of course, occasionally there is some theoretical prediction that deviates a lot, and then, you know, people go back and look at it and look at exactly what is the issue. And here, in fact, something was found as an origin of this departure, and it's been fixed. So next year, we go back and we have better theoretical calculations. Again, you know, before... You look at these and you say, I've made a discovery because this is a 2-sigma deviation from the standard model. You have to start doing some validation. So there is a whole process of convincing yourself that the anomaly you've seen is indeed physics that cannot be understood within the standard model. Here, if you just take a different calculation, you get perfect agreement. So that is an indication that perhaps there is, you know, something in your code that as an issue. Okay, so let me go back to the top quark, which I quickly started discussing yesterday. The top quark mass measured directly by the experiments is down now at the level of, I don't know if you can read it, this is the word combination from March 2014, that's the last time that the average between the Tevatron and the LHC data was taken. 173.34 plus or minus 0.27 plus or minus 0.71. So it's a plus or minus 800 MeV more or less. So it's below the GV. Since then, there have been new results by the Tevatron experiments, which are very accurate, again, with uncertainty below 1 GV, but somehow high by a couple of sigma relative to the world average. And in parallel, there is a measurement by CMS at the LHC, which again is very precise, is the single most precise measurement of a top mass from the LHC, which is a sigma and a half lower with respect to the world average. So if you add them into the world average, at the end we still stay at the same level. However, with these two measurements, which are presumably like 3.5 sigma away from each other, so it's a bit bothersome. And but you know, these things happen, right? It's that's why we have statistical and systematical uncertainties, and there are chi-square distributions, and there are probabilities, and all of that. Now, we discussed the relation between the mass and the cross-section, and I reminded you yesterday that if we're really talking about going below 1 GeV, we absolutely need to have control over the combined theoretical and experimental systematics on the cross-section to better than 3%, 2.5%, 2%. So and now we spend some time talking about the issues that arise when we directly measure the top mass in hadron collisions. And I had prepared these couple of slides to introduce the topic. And this contains the expression for the width of the topic, and many of the considerations have in fact been explored in great detail yesterday during Michael Peskin's lecture. There is one thing that, however, I would like to draw your attention to on this equation. Now, the way I wrote this equation has a G Fermi in front. It's a bit bizarre because, well, it's mostly historical, but when we actually do the calculation, you just start from a Feynman diagram in which there is the T goes to B and the W, and there is the weak coupling G in this diagram. So if we calculate this diagram square integrate over the phase space, that's the result we get, which is proportional to G square, so there is no G Fermi any longer. And this is exactly the equation that Michael wrote down on the blackboard yesterday. The one thing that I want you to go back and think about is what happens when if I take the W mass equal to zero in this expression. Because, you know, if you think of a W mass as being just a number, well, you plug it in and you get the rate. But, you know, what's wrong with just taking MW goes to zero? And you see that if we take MW goes to zero, this is not defined because this blows up. The width becomes infinite. So it's not, you know, when I say we take it to zero, you could say, well, you know, but it's not exactly zero. Fine, take it 1 GV, take it half a GV. All of a sudden, this number becomes huge, becomes immense. It becomes much, much bigger than the top mass itself, right? So that means that there is a problem there. And what I would like you to think through, because that will help you understand a bit better the issue of symmetry breaking, the Goldstone boson and everything, is whether there is a way in which the limit Mw goes to zero can be defined, whether there is a unique way of defining the limit. There are, that I could see, at least two ways in which you can define Mw goes to zero, two different ways, and in principle they could give rise to different results. And in general, you know, what are the implications of Mw goes to zero? Can I take Mw to zero without doing anything to mtop, for example, and to mb? Okay, so you sit down and you look at this and you think it through, and you will learn something hopefully useful. Unfortunately, I will not be here to discuss with you if you want, but I'm sure that you certainly, Michael, will be happy to discuss with you in case it's needed. So the other thing that I wanted to do with this expression for the width is just to plug in numbers and to give you the result. Incidentally, this extra piece, 1 minus 2 alpha over 3 pi, this is just the one loop QCD corrections to it. So we emit gluons, we exchange gluons, and there is a correction which is of the order of a few percent. So if you put in numbers, what we get is 1.34 GeV. So it's a rather wide object, not as wide as the W and the Z, but it is certainly wide, and it's so wide that it decays very quickly, and it decays so quickly that it doesn't have time to hadronize. There is some time required for the hadron to form, because the hadron means, well, the top is very heavy, right? So if you could form a top hadron, a top meson, we would have the top sitting pretty much still. It's a bit like the sun. And then the light quark, say the U-bar, going around with a radius, which is a large radius, because it's very light. Okay, so the size would be similar to the size of a pion. But the system is dominated by the tops sitting at rest, like the solar system, right? The sun in the center and the Earth going around. And the radius of the object is determined by quantum mechanics, by the uncertainty principle, will be the inverse of a light quark mass. So for this system to come together, there has to be at least the time that, you know, the quark can take a tour around the... around the center, the top, and that's too long compared to the lifetime of the top itself. So the top decays before hadronizing, and that means that there are no top hadrons to first approximation. I will come back to this issue later. Now, if you want to measure the mass of a quark, except the top quark, so of all of the other quarks, let's say the B quark and the charm quark, we know how to do it. For example, we can look at a B meson. We look at the exclusive decay of a B meson. B goes to pi pi, B goes to kk, B goes to j psi k. We fully reconstruct the final state, 2, 3, 4 particles, and the mass is equal to the sum of the momenta squared. That's the mass of the hadron. Another thing that we can do, we can take a plus and minus and go to, say, a resonance, a quark anti-quark resonance, a quarkonium state, for example, the upsilon, and the mass of the upsilon is simply the square root of S e plus and minus. And once we have the measurement of the mass of this hadron, then, of course, to go to the mass of a quark requires calculating, solving the problem of the coupling, because the mass of the hadron will be the mass of the constituents plus the energy, the binding energy, the kinetic energy, and that has to be subtracted if we want to go down to the mass of the quark, but we know how to do. There are potential models, there is lattice QCD, so as a function of lambda QCD, alpha QCD if you wish, and the masses of the hadrons, we can extract the mass of the B quark, and that's what's done in the literature, and that's where our knowledge of the B mass comes from. If the top hadronized, we could be doing exactly the same. We produce a top quark, the top quark will be joined by an anti-quark, form a top meson, it decays, and we do, at least on paper, the invariant mass as the sum of all of the decay products squared, and then from a lattice calculation, we extract the mass of the top quark from the mass of the top hadron. That doesn't happen because the top decays before. And then the following happens if we're looking at a hadron collision. This diagram represents the production process. So this is QQ bar goes to a gluon that goes to TT bar. It's one of the possible processes. And the top is colored. It decays to a B and the W. The W decays. Could be decaying leptonically. It could be decaying to quark anti-quark. It doesn't really matter. What is important is that the W is a colorless object, and therefore the invariant mass, the sum of the decay products of the W is indeed a good representation of the W. But you see, it's impossible now to add to this collection of particles coming from uniquely and without ambiguity, the decay of a B quark, because the B quark is a quark, and the B quark does hadronize. And in order for the B quark to hadronize, it has to pick up an antiquark from some place, because by itself it cannot go anywhere. And if we go back to the diagrams that we drew a couple of days ago, for example, let's say we have a gluon emitted from the initial state. The gluon then splits in a QQ bar pair. And as you see the way the color flows, this antiquark emitted from the initial state is color connected to the B quark coming from the top decay. So the B quark has to go and pull up this antiquark in order to form a B meson. And when this B meson decays, of course, then we take the particles coming from the B meson decay. And the best way we can do is to put all of these together and take the square of the sum of the momenta to get the experimental measurement of some mass. But this is not the mass of the top, because you see there is energy coming in from this antiquark. And on an event-by-event basis, that energy will be a different number. Okay? So there is no way we can just isolate the decay products of the top. Now, a priori, this is just a nuisance, right? It's not really a deep fundamental problem. Because if I had an absolutely perfect description of the hadronization process, in other words, if I were guaranteed that my description of how this B picks up an antiquark from the rest of event, well, fine. It just means that this M square will not be a peak, but will be a distribution that accounts for the fact that occasionally there is a bit more, a bit less of energy. And therefore, instead of having the sharp resonance corresponding to a fixed mass, there will be something with a broader shoulder that represents the fact that occasionally I pull in events, I pull in energy from the system. But if I know how to parameterize that shape as a function of a top mass, I could extract it. So here is a bit of a cartoon of what happens. This is the hard process. Then we attach the shower evolution, as we did the other day. The B quark starts emitting gluons. And of course, by the time it gets at the end of a B jet, it has lost its color, but it leaves the color behind. Then we have to split the gluons. We form the color singlet clusters. And as you see, there is a whole set of clusters here which are all belonging to the top, but there will always be one quark somehow that has to go and look for a partner outside, and that forms a cluster, a singlet cluster, that when it decays to possibly several hadrons whose paternity is absolutely ambiguous, right? So whether, what should we do? Should we keep them inside in the counting of the mass or not? As I said, it introduces automatically a model dependence, which you wouldn't want to have, because this is now that kind of model dependence that we don't really control from first principles. This is not perturbative QCD, right? So you really have to be confident that your hadronization modeling is safe. Fine, this is just repeating in other ways the same. Okay, so that is an issue, and you could argue, you know, one day we will really, we can put together a collection of observables that we can test against the Monte Carlos, and we will really have a guarantee that the Monte Carlo describes the hadronization process correctly. Once we've done that, and at this level, we are talking about uncertainties, at the level of a few hundred MeVs. So what we do, we take different models, and we use different models to describe precisely how that line shape gets deformed. We do the exercise of extracting the top mass from the data, and we see that the systematics is at the level of a few hundred MeV. So it's fine. It's consistent with the uncertainties that are being quoted. Question?
Yes. Right? So you could plot, I guess, somehow the mass of the top versus the size of the cone.
Yeah, he's asking the following. He's saying, of course, depending on how I define the cone, I will get more or less particles inside the cone. Yes, of course. That's why there is anyway a broadening. I'm not picking up I'm not picking up exactly. I cannot be guaranteed that I collect every single particle that comes from the top decay, of course, because I'm using a fixed cone. I get a different number, and I will get a distribution, right? And then I parameterize. If I can generate events with my Monte Carlo, in which I say, if the top mass is 170 GeV, and I use a cone of, say, 0.4, and I use that to define my jets, then I get a distribution of m squared, square root of m squared, which is this one. And this was 470. If I take 171, I get the distribution from the Monte Carlo, which is this one. And if I do 172, I get it, which is this one. So I generate templates of distributions, and I compare them against the data. And the data will fall someplace. Maybe it will fall here. And then I conclude that the mass is 171. OK? You know, experiments don't measure masses anyway, right? When a particle goes through a calorimeter, it interacts with the neutrons that deposit energy. That energy becomes light. It's taken by a light fiber. It goes to a photomultiplier, and a photomultiplier counts electrons. And we turn the number of electrons that have been seen into, at the end, GeV through a process of calibration, right? So we're not talking about a scale that you put the top on it and it tells you 1.5 kilos. The measurement is a complicated object. So this is just part of calibrating and defining templates that connect what is happening with and the way what is happening is measured to the units that we consider interesting. Okay? So let's say we have a Monte Carlo that describes absolutely the hadronization process perfectly. And then we can pull out the mass of the top. What is the mass of the top, however, in the Monte Carlo? It's a number that we put in. So it's a mass of this top quark that we use when we do the calculation of the process. And the issue is, what does that mass correspond to? And there is a debate that some of you may have heard of about as to whether it's a pole mass, it's a running mass, what is that object? Because as you know, masses like couplings in field theory, they run. So we have to define the mass in a very specific way as soon as we're dealing with radiative corrections if we want to be accurate. For example, well, the pole mass is defined in general as the mass that gives rise to a pole in the propagator. Okay? So for a stable particle, the pole mass is exactly its weight, if you wish. When the particle is stable, it's sitting there, and its mass corresponds to the pole mass. Particles which are unstable, that's not well defined. We can define the mass as being the parameter, the mass parameter, typically at the scale of the mass itself. That's what we call usually the ms bar mass, and that numbers differ from what you would call the pole mass. In the case of a top, the difference between the pole mass and the ms bar mass is about 10 GeV. So it's not a small, it's a small number, right? The difference is of order alpha s times the mass, because it comes from one loop QCD corrections. Alpha s is 0.1, the mass is 170. It's actually alpha s divided by pi, so it's a bit less than 10 GeV, but still it is a significant number. So to make you appreciate why that is relevant in the case of a top quark in hadron collisions, I want to show you a simple example, which is taken from electromagnetism, and it is the determination of the mass of a muon in an ideal experimental context that I'm about to illustrate. So let's take the muon. The muon goes to electron and two neutrinos. We could do the exercise with the muon going to electron and photon, if it did, because it's a conceptual exercise. So the mass of a muon is the pole mass is the mass of a muon, the one we would reconstruct if we take a muon in vacuum and we let it decay. And if we could measure the momentum of a neutrino, the antineutrino, this expression is the mass of a muon squared. Now let's take a muon instead, and we put it interacting with a field. And we take the muon and we put it around a proton. Okay, so we bind the muon to a proton. We have like a hydrogen atom with a muon instead of the electron. And now what we're dealing with is a system whose total energy is the mass of a proton plus the mass of a muon plus the kinetic and the potential energy. The kinetic energy of a muon, because the muon is moving, of course, and the potential energy because there is a field. And you can easily calculate the contribution of kinetic plus potential energy using the virial theorem, for example, and what you get is minus mu alpha squared divided by 2, okay, where alpha is the electromagnetic coupling. So we can still write this object as being the mass of a proton plus the mass of the muon star, where this m star is mu times 1 minus alpha squared divided by 2. So we are absorbing in the mass of the muon the field, the potential energy. And now, why is this mass m star interesting? Well, the reason why it's interesting is that if now I measure the muon mass by looking at the muon decay from this system, that's exactly what I measure. If I wait long enough till the muon decays, and now I go and I measure the energy of the electron, the energy of the neutrino, the energy of the antineutrino, I do the sum, I take the square, I'm not going to get the muon mass, but I'm going to get the mu star mass, which differs by order alpha squared. And the reason why I get a different mass is that the moment the muon decays, it has a charge, the charge is transferred to the electron, and the electron at the beginning is sitting here, is sitting where the muon was sitting. So it is embedded in an electromagnetic field. Now the electron has a lot of energy, so it cannot stay bound around the proton because it has all of the energy that came from the decay. So it goes to infinity where we do the measurement. But to go to infinity, it has to walk its way through the potential energy. And if you calculate how much energy it loses as it goes out of the field of a proton, that, of course, is exactly of order mu alpha squared, and it matches precisely this alpha squared divided by 2 correction. So if I measure the mass of a muon, when the muon is bound around the proton, I don't get the muon mass, okay? I get a different mass, m star. And now you see the tops whose mass I'm trying to measure are not objects which are in vacuum alone. They're always embedded into something because they're being created in the context of a proton-proton collision. They're interacting with all of the gluons that are around, etc. And that means that I'm certainly bound to measure something which is not exact. Even if I could define the pole mass of the top, what I'm measuring is slightly different. And this gives rise, of course, to a lot of discussions on whether the pole mass itself is well defined, how much of this energy I have to absorb. Can I find the equivalent m star? That m star that I introduced for the muon was well defined. It included the potential energy, and it was a perfect reflection of the kinematics of the muon decay products. Can I do exactly the same for the top? Can I define a mass of the top that already includes some part of the radiation field, of the energy, okay? And this is what these other masses, other than the pole mass, do. They reabsorb into the mass of the top all of these effects. The problem with the pole mass is that it absorbs these effects all the way down, integrating over wavelength, gluon wavelength, which are infinite, zero energy gluons. And of course, that is a problem because we don't know how to deal with infinite wavelength gluon because of confinement. So we need somehow to be able to incorporate in the definition of a top mass effects that are controllable from the point of view of perturbation theory, and then, if you wish, contributions to the energy that we can estimate, and the others which are of non-perturbative origin we will have to deal with in a separate way. So the bottom line is that there is an intrinsic uncertainty on the mass of the top, which on what it is, the mass that we are observing, which is of the order of alpha s times lambda QCD, which happens to be like the width of the top, so but it's actually lambda QCD. So alpha s, the crucial point is whether alpha s is alpha s calculated at the scale of lambda, so a number of order one, or whether it's alpha s calculated at the top mass. Alpha s at the top mass is 10%, so it's a small number. Alpha s calculated at the low scale is 1, so this would be a correction in the range of lambda QCD, which is of the order of a few hundred MeV. So the conclusion is that while there is, my conclusion at least, is that while there is a problem of principle, I believe that this problem is confined to scales which are, and uncertainties which are below the 500 MeV, and in fact, even less. For those of you who are, you know, working on similar issues, I just want to remind you that if you haven't seen it, a few months ago, a couple of months ago, there was a very, very important new paper, new calculation completed by Steinhauser and friends. They calculated the for-loop contribution to the conversion between pole mass and MS bar mass. So one can systematically calculate how to convert between pole and MS bar in perturbation theory. These relation is something that in the case of a B mass, it's a perturbative expansion, but it's almost, it doesn't converge, but each additional perturbative term is as large as the previous one, which is an indication that in fact the pole mass is not a well-defined mass. But in the case of the top, this series in fact is still now, even now, with a for loop calculation is still converging, and now the uncertainty on the overall conversion is at the level of a couple of hundred MeV, which indicates that at least down to the 200 MeV level, there are no issues. One small remark, there are measurements coming out from the experiments occasionally. We've seen them at the Tevatron, and even the LHC is doing them, on the difference in mass between the top and the anti-top. Now, we know that the mass of a particle is equal to the mass of its antiparticle. That's just CPT, right? It's a fundamental. So there is no way, well, unless, of course, you know, something fundamentally wrong or some fundamentally beyond the standard model is at work, we're not going to see any difference. That is certainly true for the Tevatron, which is PP bar, because being PP bar, indeed, there is full symmetry between top and anti-top. However, when we do the measurement of the top versus the anti-top mass at the LHC, it's not so obvious, because the initial state is proton-proton, the final state is quark-anti-quark. So there is an asymmetry. It's like, you know, the W plus versus the W minus. Okay? We don't have a charge asymmetry in the initial state. So when we measure the mass of the top or the mass of the anti-top in PP, in principle, we are sensitive to fine details of the hadronization process. When the top quark decays, it goes to a B, and the B has to pick up an anti-quark from the rest of the event in order to form a hadron. If it were an anti-top, it would go to a B bar, and a B bar has to pick up a quark in order to become a hadron. And of course, the number of anti-quarks and the number of quarks that are available in the collision are different just because the initial state is proton-proton. So there is clearly more quarks than anti-quarks. So it is possible that in the process of hadronization, there could develop a slight asymmetry between the way the B jet from the top decay hadronizes and the B bar jet hadronizes. And therefore, if we do the separate measurement between the top mass and the T bar mass, we might get slightly different numbers. That would not be an indication of CPT violation. It would simply be an indication of an intrinsic asymmetry in the problem. And it is interesting, because if that difference were measurable, then since it's directly connected with the hadronization process, it would be a wonderful probe. You know, we should be able to predict it, right? When we do our shower Monte Carlo, we should be able to predict what the difference is. Now, all of the calculations I myself have done tell me that that number is very small. I was not able to detect the difference between the top and the anti-top mass to better than the statistical precision of my calculations, and we are talking about certainly below 100 MeV, 50 MeV perhaps. But still, it's interesting. And the measurement now is at the level of 270, the difference 270, plus or minus 200, plus or minus 100. You see, it's dominated by statistics. So certainly, it will go down to 100 MeV. Even this systematics is dominated by statistics. So certainly, in the future, this test, we should be able to push it down to the level of maybe 50 MeV or perhaps more. And I think that that will be a very interesting exercise. A couple of remarks. QCD effects depend on how long the top actually lives, right? I said the top decays, and therefore it doesn't hadronize. And but you know, the longer it's around or the shorter it's around, the more opportunities it has to come together, because it needs to interact with the environment, right? To hadronize the top, the bee needs to interact with the environment. It needs this anti-quark to come in. And one could imagine that depending on how much the time the top lives, this interaction with the environment will change. Because if a top lives very long, and only at that point it decays, of course, the rest of the event will have a time to develop more shower. So there will be more soft gluons and more soft quarks. And therefore, when the bee has to hadronize, finds a given sample of object with which it can hadronize. If it decays very early, which it might, then, of course, the rest of the event is still undergoing the phase of very hard radiations, and the whole dynamics is different. So whether this is something that has to be taken into account in the modeling, it's something that, you know, one would have to explore. And the other thing is that occasionally, of course, with a given probability that can be calculated and which is not negligible, the top lives long enough, okay? If you look at the lifetime of a muon, look, you know, experiments where the muons are kept in a storage ring, for example, experiments measuring the G-minus 2 of a muon. The muons go on and on and on for a long time, and occasionally with the probability, of course, e to the minus tau divided by the lifetime of the muon, you still find muons, okay? And it could go on for 10, 100 times. For the top, it's really a matter of surviving twice longer than its lifetime, right? Because its lifetime is 1 divided by 1.3 GeV. The hadronization time is, you know, of the order of, say, 500, 600, 700 MeV. So if a top lives twice as long, it will hadronize. So there will be tops actually hadronizing and forming top hadrons produced at the LHC. Of course, it's hard to tell them on an event-by-event basis, and the question is whether the fact that they hadronize interferes with our modeling of the top decays in the context of reconstructing the top mass. If the top hadronizes, if the top lives long enough, we have a T-bar, and if both the top and the anti-top live long enough, maybe we even have time to form a toponym state, so a T-bar bound state. And the T-bar bound state, again, the decay will be driven by the decay of the top, but again, there is some probability that it's actually the toponym that decays and goes to gamma-gamma or goes to something else. So there is tiny probabilities that a very interesting new phenomena with the very particular, peculiar characteristics may take place, and perhaps in the future there will become new alternative probes of the top dynamics. So let me switch gears. Now let me say a few things about jets at very high energy. There is interest in these because with the LHC now going up to 13 TeV, it will be exploring jets all the way up to 4 or 5 GV, TeV in transverse energy. I discussed briefly yesterday the interest in studying the internal structure of jets, because by looking at the internal structure of jets, we could hope to understand whether it's a quark jet, a gluon jet, whether it's maybe a W decaying to hadrons. And of course, the higher is the energy, the more everything gets confused, because the jet gets squeezed, of course, the multiplicity gets larger. So here are just some examples of some quantities, okay, for jets at 1 TV, 5 TV, and I put here 10 TV. Of course, these are not accessible at the LHC, but they will become accessible if we have a higher energy collider one day. Here, for example, it's the particle multiplicity. This particle counts everything, including the neutral. So not just the charge, but the neutral assumes a stable pi zeros, so that we don't count twice for the photons. And this is a jet, so this is this is a jet. We're looking at jet with a cone of one, so it's broad enough that it contains the top, even at only one TV. So you see the difference, right? As we go up in energy, for example, the jet coming from a W going to two jets, the multiplicity distribution remains exactly the same. And that is because you know, the W is a W, right? If it has one TV or 10 TV, its decay is exactly the same. Of course, it will be more boosted, it will be more collimated, but the number of particles is not going to change because in its own rest frame, it doesn't care about how fast it's going, right? This is Galileo's relativity. This is not even Einstein. On the contrary, if we look, for example, at the top or just generic inclusive jets, you see how broader the multiplicity distribution becomes. That's because there is much more gluons being, there are many more gluons being emitted. And as we go to very high energy, you see that the top, while at low energy, the shape of a top jet is very different than the one of a B jet, because there is intrinsically much more multiplicity, because there is 170 GV of energy that get released no matter what. But as we go to higher and higher energy, they become more and more similar. And that's because at this point, the mass of the top is negligible relative to the 10 TV. The additional number of tracks coming from the top decays is only a fraction of the huge, look at the multiplicities here, 200, right? 150, so that is a lot. This is the shape of the multiplicity. In other words, I used jets of cone one, and then we want to look at how this multiplicity, how these tracks are distributed within the jet. So what I do now, I count the number of tracks within a cone of radius little r, and I take the ratio, you know, the fraction of tracks which are contained within that small cone. And again, you see in the case of a W, sorry, it's not the fraction, this is the absolute number. In the case of a W, as we go to very high energy, they're pretty much all within a cone of 1%, r equals to 0.01. I mean, it's really a tiny, tiny angle. And that contains pretty much all of the decay products. While certainly for inclusive jets and for tops, they're much more spread. So by just looking at this observable, it's immediate somehow the distinction between a jet that's coming from a W decay into QQ bar to a jet which is an inclusive jet, right? One doesn't need to do very sophisticated things. Now, that was number of particles. Of course, it depends how much energy the particle carries. So another interesting observable is the energy shape. What's the fraction of energy? And this is now fraction, yes. What's the fraction of energy contained within a little cone? And again, look at the W, right? It saturates pretty much all of the energy of a jet. I use the jet of radius one. It doesn't matter, right? All of the energy is within 0.0 something. The details of the shapes, I mean, one can sit down, look at them, they're qualitatively reasonable. And this is the mass distribution. Now, of course, the mass distribution for the W should be exactly the W mass, no? Well, it's not in this case because this is really the full. I'm working with a full proton-proton event goes to a W plus a jet. So there is initial state radiation, there is other particles going around. And of course, to the extent that I work with a cone of radius one, there will be additional particles coming in, and that's why I develop a tail. But clearly the peak is at exactly the W mass. So what is done typically in the experimental analysis is to put together all of these ingredients, where perhaps case by case there may not seem to be great differences between a very high PT top and a very high PT B jet or inclusive jet, but even slight differences, when we pile them up, we take a product of likelihoods of different shapes, we can build discriminants which turned out to be useful in reducing backgrounds or isolating signals. And this is a very interesting game that has become a branch of LHC phenomenology since a few years now. I have a few more discussions here. Let me, since I don't want to go much longer, I want to leave at least 10, 15 minutes for possible discussion at the end. Let me come to one topic that I think is interesting. We are talking about high ET jets. And there is another interesting thing that happens when we are dealing with very high multi-TV jets. And that is that the radiation of W and Z bosons start become a non-negligible effect. Typically, if we look at, let me start from the end, in fact. Yeah, let's look at this table. I don't know how visible it is, but so what I have here is cross-sections for production of several bosons at 13 TV. So this is the W cross-section, the Z cross-section, WW cross-section, WZ, WWW, 4Ws, 5Ws, whatever. And now let's look at what's the probability of emitting an extra W. So the ratio of WW over W cross section is 5.5, 0.6 per mil. 3Ws over 2Ws is 2 per mil. 4Ws over 3Ws is 5 per mil. So we're really talking about few per mils, right? And the reason is that there is an alpha weak divided by pi. And adding a mass, of course, costs in terms of how much energy we have to put in the system. So the bottom line is that it takes, we lose a factor of 10 to the minus 3 every time we add an extra W. We see that this number becomes larger here. This is exactly the same reasoning as we did in the case of the jets, right? If we only have one W and we want to create two, we have to double the energy required. If we have already 3W and we want to go to 4, we only have to add 30% extra energy. So the penalty in terms of alpha of couplings is more or less the same, but it only costs a little bit more, so that's why it becomes more likely. The other interesting thing is that if we have several Ws, emitting one more means that that extra W can couple to each one of those Ws or Zs. And the coupling of Ws among themselves is quite strong. So there is an advantage to Ws coupling to Ws rather than Ws coupling to quarks. That we see, for example, in this line here. This is the ratio between the cross-section to produce a W and the cross-section to produce a Z. And this number is equal to about 3. If we put in leptonic branching ratios, say Z goes to E plus E minus, that's about 3%. W goes to electron neutrino, that's about 1/9, 11%. So there is a factor of 3.5. So 3 times 3.5, it's about factor of 10. So the cross section for a W that goes to electron divided by a Z that goes to E plus E minus is about 10. This number 10, which is easy to remember. It's doubly easy because it's not just specific to the LHC at 13 TV, but it's been true in the whole history of hadron colliders. That number was measured as being, I say 10, and it's 10 plus or minus, 1 plus or minus 0.5, but just as an order of magnitude. That number is a constant. It was 10 when the W and the Z were discovered at the super proton antiproton SP P bar S at CERN. It was 10 at the Tevatron, and it is 10 at the LHC at 7, 8, and 13 TV. And that reflects this ratio 3 simply reflects the strength of a coupling of the W and the Z to the initial state quarks, to the U and D bar. So it's just the weak couplings, okay? So the coupling of the Z to the UU bar and the DD bar, it's slightly less than the coupling of the W to U2 bar. So that's what we see here. As we go to having more and more Ws and Zs around, for example, if we look at the ratio between WW and WZ, so we have an extra W, you see that from 3 we drop to 2. If we look at 3 Ws to which we add a W relative to 3 Ws to which we add a Z, this ratio now is 1. And it's 1 because at this point, adding the W or the Z, you know, we're more likely to do it adding them to the final state gauge bosons as opposed to the initial state. So what we are seeing with these ratios going to 1 is that the W or the Z are pretty much the same object. So in a sense, as we go to higher W multiplicities, we are restoring the SU2 symmetry because we are just talking about the couplings among of Ws and Z among themselves. The quarks are pretty much idle in this process. It's much more likely to add extra bosons to the final state than to the initial state. So this evolution reflects here the coupling to the quarks, and down here is the quote-unquote restoration of SU2 symmetry between, between the gauge bosons. Anyway, so we started by saying it's 10 to the minus 3. Now let's see what happens when we go to very high energy jets. Final states in which there is very high energy jets can emit Ws with much larger probabilities. And in fact, let's look at this figure. This is the probability, well, this is the ratio, for example, of jet-jet plus W divided by jet-jet as a function of the ET minimum of the jets. In other words, we take final state with 2 jets, and we require the leading jet to have ET larger than a given threshold. 1 TV, 2 TV, 3 TV, etc. And in these events, where we have 2 jets, of which one at least is above, say, 3,000 GeV, I go and count the number of Ws that I find in these final states. And what I find is a number which already at 3 TeV is of the order of 10%, and it goes up to 15% at 5 TeV. Okay, so the LHC will be probing jets with transverse energies up to 4, 5 TeV, and in each of these events, one out of 8 of these events, there will be a W. So we go from the 10 to the minus 3 probability of emitting a W in a generic event to a 10 to the minus 1. It's an increase by a factor of 100 probability of emitting a W in an event in which there is high energy jets. And that's because there is a huge, we're already putting so much energy right into the system, these 5, 10 TeV, that adding a little W doesn't cost much in terms of energy. So that develops a very large logarithm that contributes to increasing the rate. Of course, these Ws will be relatively soft, right? Because if they also have very, very high energy, then of course it would cost a lot of energy. So typically the configurations are configurations in which there is 2 jets back-to-back and then a very wimpy, soft W or Z being emitted. Of course, this is interesting because it can contaminate searches for BSM physics. It can have interesting phenomenology. One could use, for example, if for whatever reason, above 5 TeV, all of the jets were gluons, then of course there would be no W produced, right? This is because we have the right amount of of quark jets. If we look at the resonance, let's say we have 8 TeV resonance that decays to 4 TeV jets, we see the jets, but we don't know a priori whether it's gluons or quarks because it's a resonance and it could be its new physics, it may be coupling to quarks or to gluons. If we see that systematically all of the 2 jet events coming from the decay of this resonance, there is no W being emitted, no Z being emitted, it might mean that in fact it is gluons. If we see Ws being emitted and Z being emitted, it will happen with a probability of the order of 10-15% if it's standard model couplings, maybe more if it is couplings which are stronger than standard model, and one can use the rate of W versus Z to understand more precisely what is the nature of these particles that come from the decay of this new resonance. So all of these things, you see, were completely inconceivable until a few years ago because we just didn't even have energy. At the Tevatron, there was no energy. Even at 8 TV LHC, there was not enough energy to start exhibiting these phenomena. And these are the things that now we have to deal with in the context of very high-energy colliders. And typically, the right way of looking at these phenomena is as opportunities rather than as problems. It's problems because it means that there are more things that one has to take into account, there are more things that one has to calculate, there are more effects that one has to account for if one wants to make precise predictions. But at the same time, each of these, the diversity that emerges from these phenomena is an opportunity for further exploration. So I have a few more things, but I think that, yeah, I'd rather stop here. I thank you very much for your attention. We have still 10 minutes, I would say, for discussion, so I really hope that you will be able to ask possible final questions before I go. Thank you.